passages of chapter 5 of the book of Galatians, verse 17. It reads as follows. It says, "For the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. They are contrary one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would." That being said, my desire for today's message will cause you to examine yourself. Once you examine yourself, you come to your findings. My other goal in this is that you would make the necessary adjustments to conform your life to God's will. Don't be offended because you have to make adjustments, because everybody in here has to make some adjustments. Amen? Well, the Bible speaks about a war and a battle that takes place within ourselves. It is a daily war, and it affects our walk in the Lord. There are two things in this battle that we'll focus on today: the flesh and the spirit. It is within these two things which determine the outcome. Your appetite will instantly let you know what you are producing. Some of you may be familiar with this type of examination, while others may not. I've taught on the subject matter on a number of occasions. I felt it was very important today to, and especially in this time of season, that we would examine ourselves to determine who dominates our soul. The name of my message today is, "Who is winning the fight?" Well. One thing I'd like to point out before you examine yourself, you must be honest with your findings. You know, usually when we examine ourselves, we want to make ourselves either too good or too bad. And sometimes you need the aid of others to assist you in examining yourself. You got to be able to take what they tell you. How many of you got some close church buddies you can take what they tell you? Raise your hand. If you don't, look at your neighbor and say, "You need a friend, I'm available." Oh, wow, who said that? One thing about it, if you're going to, it's important for you to be in a relationship with someone you can be accountable to. And it's important for that person to be, you know, a trustworthy person, because you don't want to tell everybody your business. Look at your neighbor and say, "You can't tell everybody your business." So it need to be some dear or close brother and sister in the Lord that you can make aware of your results, and hopefully they are able to help you. Now, the purpose we are examining ourselves is so we can improve, to be more effective in serving the Lord. You know, I've been pushing this campaign about being active, not just coming to church to feel good, but coming to church to do good. In order to do good, you need to be in service. What I mean, not come to service, but take an active role in service. Hello? I was just going over some of the ministries that we have here, and I had some people tell me that there wasn't enough stuff for them to do. And I was like, wow, that's kind of deep. Let me look up some of these things I found. I found that we had at least 20 ministries here to be involved in, whether it's nurseries, the youth, security greeters, ushers, health ministry, nurses ministry, seniors ministry, women, men ministry, I got prison ministry going, we got ministry visiting the nursing home, so it's all kind of stuff to do. The Bible said the harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few. So we're going to be doing some things in the Lord. So if I stop and ask you what you're doing, don't get scared. I might do that. Amen? Now, the purpose is it's for us to examine ourselves that we may improve and serve the Lord, and that we will conform to the will that God has for our lives. All the churches in the body of Christ throughout the world are at different levels of maturity. And it's very important to know where you are spiritually, and knowing where you are will help you to get to where you need to be. See, if you don't know where you are, you won't know how to get to where you need to go. Amen? Amen? So, the purpose of examining ourselves is so we can improve in serving the Lord. Now, I would like to use an old story. This message is going to be short because we got communion, but this story is so powerful. I've told it so many times, I can't even count it. But it's a story, it's an old story, and I don't even know if it's a true story or a fictional story, but trust me, it's very beneficial to your growth in the Lord. Amen? Because if it wouldn't, it wouldn't be on my sheet. So, like I said, I've told this story so many times, I can't even comment. Being honest with me, I just told you, I don't even know if this is a fictional story or a true story. Nevertheless, the story makes it easier for us to examine ourselves. And it is, if this is your first time hearing this story, look at your neighbor and say, you're in for an eye opener. Listen to this. This is a story about a man that lived in a town. And this man that lived in this town, he owned two dogs. And he would allow these two dogs to fight each other every week. Every week, the dog, fighting against each other. And so the citizens of the town would come to watch these animals fight each other. And every week, he would tell them which dog would win the fight. Every single week. And so one of the town members says, which dog is going to win this fight this week? And he would say, well, it's going to be the brown dog. He had two dogs, a black dog and a brown dog. The guy would say, I don't know how the brown dog will win this week because he just lost last week. The owner said, well, he won't lose this week. So they fought. The brown dog win. Next week, come and ask him which dog will win. He says, the black dog. He said, well, how could the black dog win when the brown dog just won last week? And so finally they were all puzzled, and finally one of them stepped up and asked him and says, how do you always know which dog gonna win the fight every week? And he tells them, it's the one that I feed.
Watch out.
Listen to this, saints. You have a flesh and you have a spirit. The one that you feed will win that fight every week. You feed your body of flesh. The things of the flesh, you know, we're going to go over what they are because I don't want you to be confused about what the things of the flesh are. Adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, and that's referring to moral issues. Lasciviousness, that's unbridled lust. Idolatry, worshiping false gods, witchcraft, dealing with potions and drugs, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, sedition and heresies, false teaching, envying, murders, drunkenness, reviling, as such like of which I tell you before, the Bible says, I have told you in time past, they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
Amen.
So, if your life has been an active role in those things, you know that you've been feeding your flesh. Let me tell you about the flesh. The more you give the flesh, the greater the appetite becomes. If you got a problem with sex, if you participate in sex, now you want more sex. If you got a problem with drinking, now you want more drinking. So it's very important for you to proceed with caution. Because what you put in, it was comes out of you. If you feed the flesh, you'll serve the flesh. But if you feed the spirit, somebody needs to say amen.
Amen.
You feed the spirit, the things of God, then you will have power over the flesh. You can say no to the desires of the flesh. The way you kill something is you don't feed it. Hello?
Amen.
Or if you get it to a place where it becomes so weak, you can take control of it. Some of us have been feeding the flesh, and on the weekends or a few days a week might feed the spirit, but you've been losing those battles.
Oh, yes.
Now, if we're going to be led by the spirit and walk by the spirit, we need to be filled with the spirit. It is a true saying that, according to the Bible, that every believer is sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, Ephesians 1:13. That's true. But being sealed is not the same as being filled. You can be sealed with the Spirit. That means you say your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, but not filled. When you feel with the Spirit, you're under the influence of the Spirit, and the things that it will cause you to do are things that please God and that glorify God. So don't get the two mixed up. I'm sealed. I need you to be filled. Hello? Because if you're going to do what pleases God, then you're going to have to take in some godly things. If you're going to be under the influence of the Holy Spirit, then you must be led by the Spirit.
Amen.
So you're going to have to make some adjustments. What are those adjustments? Instead of me cussing you out, I can pray for you. Instead of me wanting to knock you out, I can say peace. In the name of Jesus unto you. Instead of me being impatient, I can become patient. I can have self-control. I can have some joy, peace in the Holy Ghost, in the Holy Spirit. You know, there's some things, there's some fruit that you need to take in. You know, I'm on a diet. I'm all on this health food kick now. I was looking at some pictures of my bill in my younger days. That's not too long ago. And then I was looking at the pictures now. This didn't all just happen in one day. Creeps in. See, the enemy will creep in like a little fox. He said, it's the little foxes that spoil the vine. Just a little of this and a little of that. Next thing you know, it's a problem. I told you when I was a little kid, my brother used to have this big old jar full of quarters and 50 cent pieces and stuff. And I went in there, and when I heard the ice cream truck, okay. So I would hit that jar. Ice cream truck came out a lot this summer. But one time I looked back up, and the jar was almost to the top. And then one day I looked, and the jar was way down here. I didn't notice that I took all those things out of there. So now I'm saying, ain't no way he's going to come in and not notice that. See, we've been doing some things that we think that God hasn't noticed. We only did a little of this and a little of that and a little of this and a little of that. Didn't hurt that much. But a little of this and a little of that get you in trouble. Because one thing about sin caused you to commit other sins. It's a common thing that normally when a seed is planted, a common seed, it produces at least seven times its kind. They say sin is somewhat like that seed. If you do this, now you might have to lie about that. If you say this, you might have to lie about that. Sin caused you to commit other sins. But if you do righteous, it's contagious too. If you see that pleasing the Lord comes with blessings, then you need to abandon your wicked ways. You need to watch what you eat and how much you eat. And you need to watch the people that you eat with. And so we want to shift after we examine ourselves and see just what we have been producing. It's very important for you as a child of Most High God to produce glory because that's your purpose for being on this earth.
Amen.
I know some of you thought your purpose would be a king or queen or you know, Miss This or Mr. That. But your whole purpose for being on this globe is that God may be glorified.
Amen.
So you can't go to some of the places you used to go. You can't do some of the things you used to do. And another thing you need to quit doing is missing what you used to do. Because what you used to do was not pleasing unto God. And so now we have to check ourselves and examine ourselves to look what we have been taking in. Because if we have been feeding the flesh, then it's been dominating our spirits. But if we have been feeding the Spirit, it should dominate our flesh. And let me go over some of the things about the fruit of the Spirit. The Bible here in Galatians 5:22 says, the fruit of the Spirit is love. Pastor Carl's teaching about love. He said, love is patient. Love is kind. Have you been kind? Have you been patient? Because if not, maybe you need to extra dose of love? How many need an extra dose of love? How many think you got enough love in you? You're good to go. Yeah, don't raise your hand. You're going to look bad. Don't look good for you. It says, now look, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering. That means you can take a hit and not complain.
All
right. Long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Ooh, that's a tough one right there. Temperance is self-control. How many of you like self-control? Don't raise your hand, just nod. Self-control. It says, against such there are no laws. And they that are of Christ have crucified the flesh, or put the flesh to death with the affections of their lusts. And lust is a strong desire. You can lust for righteousness. But most of us, when the word lust comes up, it's not a good thing. And so we want to go from not being a good thing to being a good thing. And it's amazing how a believer in Christ can be saved, sanctified, filled with the Spirit, but still has some sinful habits. How many of y'all know that the Lord's not through with you yet?
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say, we all got issues, so don't point the finger. All of us came up short. How many of you went 30 days without sinning? Raise your hand. I got one person right here. I need to see you after class. How many of you went 10 days without sinning? Raise your hand. About 10 minutes. You know, the Bible says if you have a thought in your mind that's evil or desire to do, that's sin as well. So in order for us to get on this train, we have to give ourselves some real evaluations. For the most part, you ain't going 30 days without sin. Look at your neighbor. See, if you do, praise the Lord, but it's going to be a tough scene. We can shoot for the stars, for the moon, but we might just make it to the cloud. But it's better than where we were. Amen? But in order to get to where you need to be, you need to really identify where you are. And so, if we're not where we need to be, we need to make some preparations to get there. In order to make some preparations, we need to be able to hear from the Lord.
Amen.
Remember, I told you it's important for us to pray, and I talked about prayer, type of prayers, and how many times a day you should pray, and the various postures for praying. But one thing I neglect to tell you all, and I need to tell it today. Once you get through praying to the Lord, you need to have a pause so you can hear if he has something to say to you. Because most of us, when we get through praying, we wrap it up and leave. We don't wait for the moment for the Lord to speak to us because we're not used to the Lord speaking to us. And if he was to speak to us, it would probably scare us. When you pray, you should pray with the expectation that God's going to respond to you. So if you're expecting something, you need to wait for it. So once you make your request known, your supplications, your petitions unto God, have some pause time in between there to see if he just might say something to you that day.
Amen?
Amen. So now look, here we go, the dog's fighting. He picked which dog was going to win. And he found out the one that I feed wins. Every time. Not some of the time, every time. If you take in the fruit of the Spirit, if you suck in the things of God, it's guaranteed victory. How many like losing? Raise your hand. Wow, nobody like losing here. Isn't that funny? How many like winning? We like winning, right? If Jesus is victory, and everything that has victory will lead you to Jesus, because he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is God Almighty. searched all over, couldn't find nobody, nobody greater, nobody mightier, nobody more powerful. He's a God whose plans can't be checked. You can't change his plans. You can't turn back his will. If we know that he's a God that's like that, he's a loving God and a caring God and a God that's a God of peace. And I belong to him. And I'm having some issues. The first thing I need to do is run right to Jesus. I need to conform to his ways, because his ways lead to victory. His ways leads to peace. His ways lead to joy. His ways leads to victory.
Come on.
Oh, I don't know, some of y'all still sleeping. What y'all do last night? I had to stay up last night. I was in a little pain. But I was reading and writing things about the Lord. And when I was standing, he trapped in this little MRI machine. And I told the man, I can't really lay down on my back. But he must have thought I was joking. Because he left me in there for about 25 minutes. I think I said every prayer. Lord, please. It was a tough ride. But when it finished, I said, I got through it.
Jesus.
There's some stuff we just got to go through for the glory of the Lord. There's some problems that you need to go through so you can grow up. I'm reminded of my favorite character in the Old Testament, David. When Goliath showed up, David went before the king and said, the Lord has delivered me from a lion and a bear. You know what I'm saying? I got some practice in winning. So this shouldn't be no different from the other. Because why? Because I'm in the covenant with you. You got to know in your darkest hour, you in the covenant with the Lord. He's responsible for you. He is your shepherd and you is his sheep. And the shepherd is responsible for caring for his sheep. Yes, he is. He's responsible for feeding the sheep, for protecting the sheep, for nurturing the sheep, and to keep the sheep calm so they know how to act right.
Come on,
you know, part of my job is to keep you calm too. Because you know, some of you don't act right all the time. I don't want to call your name out, but you know we are. Every so often we have to have a sit down. And guess what? That's a part of being a shepherd.
Yeah.
It's a part of being a sheep. I wouldn't know how to act if everybody act right. Would you? So listen. We got to ask ourselves, what are we doing to get closer to God?
Yes.
We see that what we're doing is causing us to build a gap in between the Lord and us. We need to remove it.
Yes. Amen.
So that means maybe some of your friends need to be put on hold.
Yeah.
You know, you got that call away, somebody call, you click over, talk to somebody, then you call, hey, I'm going to have to call you back, this is for my job or something. Sometimes you might have to put some of your buddies on hold till you can fix yourself.
Jesus.
And then once you fix yourself, well, I'm trying to help them, you need to help yourself.
Jesus.
Hello?
Jesus.
You know, I heard a speaker say this, this guy is a real radical guy, but he says, the lepers came to get healed. The person that heals a leper cannot be one.
Jesus.
Hello?
Come on.
If you're going to heal somebody, you don't need to be sick, do you?
Amen.
You need to work at fixing yourself before you want to fix everybody else. They got an old saying that you need to sweep your porch off first before you start talking about sweeping somebody else's off. And so, the meat of the matter is all of this is you got to proceed with caution on what you're taking in. If those things that I spoke to you about, witchcraft, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, sedition, heresy, hate, lasciviousness, fornication, uncleanliness, if those things in your life, you've been eating fleshly food. And guess what? Flesh food don't last long. Hello? Anything that you can see with your eye is temporary. things of God are unseen, but they're eternal. They're everlasting. Do you want to give all you got for the temporary? Are you willing to take the temporary and give up the everlasting? You know what, when I was suffering, I was dealing with this pain, it was like excruciating. I was like, wow, I'm 58. I never in my life had pain stay like this ever. But when it was on me, it ran me right to Jesus. Some of you be dealing with some issues, and instead of running to Jesus, you run to your girlfriends and your friends. This stuff here means we got to run to Jesus. He is the changer. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the life changer. So I come to praise the Lord today. Yes, yes, yes. The enemy thought he had us down here. Thought he had Pastor Carr down. Didn't miss a beat.
Come on.
You can't even tell nothing's wrong with him. I had somebody ask me, are you going to come to church today?
What you think?
That offended me. I'm thinking maybe you won't be there, but I'll be there. And I just got going to be here because I'm the pastor. I'm here because I love fellowship. I love the name of Jesus. I love to talk about Jesus. I love to sing about Jesus. I love to read about Jesus. I love Jesus. And when I think about his goodness and all that he's done for me. Some of y'all, man, I'm going to get to some of you. You're going to make me stand up. You're going to make me stand up. I'm going to testify. If it wasn't for the goodness of God, I'd have been consumed by the fire of enemy. But the Lord has loved me and he brought me through the fire. And he called me his own. He made me his shepherd. He put a new song in my soul. How I love Jesus. Just because he first loved me. Some of you have been drug addicts and dope fiends and liars and fornicators. But the Lord has set you free. Some of you have healed you so good. I can't tell your elbow was broke. I can't tell you was wounded. I can't tell you wasn't saved. So you come to church and sit on your hands. I can't sit on my hands. I come to say, thank you, Jesus. Yes, yes, yes. He is my way out of no way. He is my Prince of Peace. He is the King of Glory. He is the Ancient of Days. He is my shield, my buckler, my strong tower. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah that breaks the chain and destroys the yoke. He is the man of death. He is the living water. He is the keeper of my soul. Oh, how I love you. Moses was scared and said, who should I send? Send them. Tell them I am sent you. The self-sustaining God. Your present help. He is my present help in a time of trouble. Somebody should be able to testify with me. I'm not the only one that God's been good to. I'm not the only one that's been through a fire and been through a storm. I'm not the only one.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. 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 My hallelujah belongs to the Lord. He's the joy bells ringing in my soul. He gives me water when I'm thirsty. He gives me peace in the midst of trouble. He comforts me and calls me his own. He's the light of my life. Oh, hallelujah. I was weary, you gave me rest. Yes. Lost, but now I'm fine. I'm a miry clay, but he's lifted me up and he picked me up. He called me his own.
I expect to win because God has called me here. And if he called you in, expect to win. Expect the sun to shine on your street.
Glory.
Yes. Expect new greatness.
The Bible said with the greatness of his excellence. That's the kind of God that calls us out. So I don't care what the enemy had planned for us, whatever sickness upon me, I'll bless the name of Jesus from the rising of the sun to the setting of the day. His name is great and he's worthy. Yes, Christ said, they told me I got colon cancer. They got to cut it out. Preach last Sunday. Oh, bless the man.
Thank you, Lord.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord our God. The Bible says he is who was, is, and is to come. A God of the past, present, and the future. Victory is in the name of Jesus. And when he told him, when he delivered from Pharaoh, he said, you will never see them again. That's the victory. I never go back to what I used to be. The enemy can't snatch me away. You can't buy me off. I can't be sick enough, broken enough. Nothing can turn me back.
Who win in the fight?
We win.
Win.
If you have trouble reading the Bible, I'm going to help you out today. Forget them 66 books. Go to one. Revelation.
Glory.
We win.
We win.
No more sickness. No more sorrow. No more pain. No more suffering. He said, behold, I make all things new. We don't have to wait till the end to recognize we win. If you look good enough, you'll see it right now. And if you know that you win right now, some of you might want to just praise him right now. Some of you want to praise him in advance because it's a good thing coming your way. You don't have to wait till you get to the end of the train to say thank you. You don't have to wait till the resurrection to say thank you to praise his name. You can praise his name right now. You can praise his name right now. You can shout right now. You can blow the trumpet right now. You can put your hands up right now. You can stomp your feet right now. You can shake off your garment right now.
Like Jesus. Nobody can rock me in the midnight hour like Jesus.
You're worthy. So worthy.
It's just giving way more.
Hallelujah. Glory to your name.
Glory.
Jesus.
Glory. Power, majesty.
We exalt your name.
Yes.
We magnify your name. We glorify your name.
Love.
There's no other name. Love.
I love you. I love Jesus. I love Jesus. Love Jesus. Look at your neighbor and say, we not through with us yet.
There's power.
There's him in the midst of this. Don't know who the Lord has asked you to come right now. Come right now and taste and see that the Lord is good. Come to Jesus. Come. All sins forgiven. all my charges, all my transgressions, been removed. I had a big list. I had a big list. And he cleared it out. I had issues. And he fixed them.
Oh, sister in heaven, Father, we